Good morning. It's January the 17th, the second Sunday after Epiphany in 2021. I'm Robin Jacobson, and this is the very empty sanctuary of the Trinity United Church in Vernon, British Columbia, where we usually meet on the unceded territory of the Okanagan Silk. Welcome. The psalmist invites us in Psalm 46 to be still and to know that I am God. Please know that as we come together in that stillness to worship God now, we are not alone. Christ promises by his Spirit of peace to be wherever there is a gathering in his name. And so, lighting this Christ candle, may we be assured of that promise, and may the stillness of Christ's peace be with you. And so we share that with one another. The peace of Christ be with you. Live within this cloud, this swirling mass of electromagnetic communication fields, all moving and pulsing around us and probably also within us constantly, all simply needing our receptivity, just waiting for us to activate some other receptive mechanism in order to be able to experience them. I mean, we can just switch on a radio set. And wherever we are, bam, there's sound, or a television set, we tune it in and there's a picture, visuals. We connect by Wi-Fi and suddenly we're part of the virtual universe of the internet, the whole world wide web. Those are only the things that we can imagine. What about all the other fields that are around us, all the energy around us? The better or the more sophisticated our receiving devices, the better our ability to receive that communication. What we do know is that in the scriptures, we have an image of God as poured out love, just constantly waiting to communicate with us, nudging, whispering, shoving, urging, calling, and all the time, just waiting for the tuning in of our receptors that we may get it. In the creation narratives, we find God choosing never to be alone, but to be about creating a cosmos and a humanity with which to interact and to have a relationship. It's as if God chooses not to be alone, won't be alone. Relationship and communication, it seems, is at the very essence of who and what God is and does. And so, when that human connection was lost because of humanity's sinful obsession with greedy and ambitious self-preservation, you know, the story of Adam and Eve, the narratives in Genesis, we find God not willing just to give up on humanity, but as coming close, constantly calling out, Adam, meaning humanity, my people, where are you? Come back. And that is still God's most burning question of us as we distractedly wander off into whatever it is that we are focusing on. We are created to know sacred communication. We are created for holy communion. We find this God calling out amongst the highest points of Scripture, and at times even actually being heard by those who are given enough receptivity to hear. There's old Abraham, who was able to hear God's promises to him, and so became the father of nations. Or we can see middle-aged Moses, who heard as he was being spoken to from out of that burning bush in the desert, and so a nation came to be set free. Or as in today's text, the story of this young boy Samuel, who also got to hear. Philip is reading for us from 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 1 through to verse 10.
Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel," and he said, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called to me." But he said, "I did not call, lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called to me." But he said, "I did not call, my son, go lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called to me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling to the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls to you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went down and lay in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening."
This all happened at night, where the tabernacle was being set up in the dark, probably representing the church of that time. We're specifically told that old Eli, probably representing the state of Israel's priesthood, that he was sleepy with dim eyes and hardly able to see. Also that the lamp of God was just about going out. Light, as we know, being a symbol of God's, of people's awareness of God's presence and purposes. There's lots of negative imagery here in this scripture. The Church of Israel wasn't doing so well. Some 400 years later, we find Isaiah still absolutely merciless in his attack on the state of the church and the priesthood. "God's watchmen are all blind," he writes in Isaiah chapter 56. "Ignorant. They are all dumb dogs which can never have enough. They are shepherds which cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone to his own gain." And yet the truth of God's love and all the implications of that are evident all around us, just straining to be noticed, just straining to be received. Dear God, may we allow ourselves to be tuned in. The point being that we should never lose our yearning for living out of something so much higher than just this two-dimensional ego world with which we are so easily allowed to become defined. This world choked simply by ourselves and our own self-interests. That's not enough. And yet that is what was happening back then, and still so easily at what is happening now. The Samuels of the world actually hear the call of God and actually do come to live out their lives from an awareness of this deeper truth. They get that there is so much more to our reality than just what may seem to be good or bad for just ourselves. With all the many changes and confusions and distractions of our everyday lives, Of course, it's no surprise for us to find at times that our eyes have become dimmed or our ears somehow blocked. May our prayer be that we are able to keep that humility of mind, that open receptivity that, like Samuel, allows us to be able to say, "Speak, your servants are listening." In a world currently so divided, rich and poor, captive, free, healthy, sick, conservative, liberal, a world of climate change activists and climate change deniers, just what do you believe God may be just straining to communicate with you, even right now, personally, wanting to speak to you about yourself or about others or about creation? And then, how does what you may be hearing actually influence you, affect and effect your behavior? Just how have you heard God speaking to you?
Well, I've never had a heavens opening up, the Lord's booming voice speaking down to me moment, nor have I had immediately a recognition that the Lord was speaking to me. But I have had several occasions where, in hindsight, I could see that the Lord was speaking to me through others. Most recently, it happens where I work, at the care home, Carrington Place, maybe because those are the only people that I see these days, but the Lord finds a way. Many different things, reassurances, thankfulness, just telling me that I am beloved and appreciated. One woman in particular, who unfortunately recently passed away, she would always tell me that God made me special and that the Lord's watching me and blessing my hands, things like that. And even though she's now in heaven, she's still communicating to me through her book that she gave to me a long time ago, and I started it and kind of just put it to the side, but now that she's gone, I've picked it back up, and it's really quite surprising, the connection. She had two children who ended up both being blind, and it's talking about her learning through this experience and learning to follow God's will even through all this hardship. And it's funny how it correlates with Eli's blindness and Nathaniel's having to listen, and it's very much her, kind of, I guess it's kind of reversed, but in some ways it's not. It's still her teaching her children, despite their blindness, how to love the Lord. And I'm just thankful that I have the opportunity to learn from however God wishes me to learn from, and that I can hear Him however He wishes it.
This is so beautiful. Thank you, Jessey, for sharing. And thank you, God, for speaking through this precious woman, and particularly for Jessie's openness to being able to hear you, God, speak through her. There is a very real sense in which God is communicating with us even now. But then, as we allow ourselves to listen, we should know that there are very real implications to what we may be hearing. And so I ask again, how does what you may ever be hearing from God actually influence, affect, or effect your behavior? We know from the verses following today's text that God convicted young Samuel to have to go and do a very specific thing. He was to confront old Eli's sons, the very ones who were described earlier as being scoundrels, whose sin was very great in the eyes of God. That wasn't going to win him any friends. And so we're told in verse 15 that Samuel just lay there until the morning. Can you imagine him understandably terrified to have to go and do what God had told him to do? But then he did so. Anyway, he was able to respond and do what he felt convicted to. It's as we allow ourselves to tune in that we allow ourselves to be sent out. What are you being sent out to do in 2021? When it comes to our noticing world hunger, we are deeply grateful for the work of the Canadian Food Grains Bank, because clearly someone there was listening. And through them, we got to hear God as well, and we got to act.
Hello, everyone. My name is Andy Harrington, and I'm the Executive Director of the Canadian Food Grains Bank. I'm here to give a thanks to you across our network for all you've done to make our work possible this year. It's been a tough year for many of us. I'm coming to you from my basement, as I know many of you are in that working situation as well. But as well as me wanting to thank you, there are people from across the world that you've supported, and some of them are here as well. So I want to hand over to Caitlin. She's one of our supporters. She's from a farming community in Saskatchewan. She's actually speaking to us from there. Good morning, Caitlin.
Good morning, Andy, and thank you. I had the opportunity to travel to India with the Canadian Food Grains Bank to learn and see projects firsthand. I met local farmers who are benefiting from agriculture training programs funded by the Canadian Food Grains Bank. The agriculture training programs are successful because of the hard work by local staff around the world who turn the support into practical programs that make a difference. I had the honor to meet and learn from Pabitro, a local staff member in India.
Thanks, Captain. There is so much to be thankful for these days. Here in India, I am grateful for the communities, wonderful communities, where MCC works. We have so much energy and ingenuity. Thanks for this great partnership from across the Food Grains Bank network.
On behalf of the board and members of the Canadian Food Grains Bank, thanks for the ways in which the network comes together to work towards a world without hunger. This is an amazing network, from our grassroots farmers, to our communities, to our churches, the general public, all the way to the Canadian government, who so generously worked together in making this possible. Thank you. Now back to you, Andy.
Thanks, Ken, and thanks everyone. It's a beautiful thing to be able to sit here across the world and speak on video. But we really want to thank all of you who are watching as well. Thanks for the emergency food help that you've helped us provide this year through drought, through conflict, and through this crazy time of COVID-19, even in the explosion in Lebanon. Thanks for those of you who took time to write a letter or send a postcard to your elected official or shared about world hunger in your classroom or your small group. It's through all these efforts that we can make a difference. Thanks for your prayers, especially at this time of year, with all that's going on in the world, and for those who we know are going to bed hungry this evening. So thank you for what you do and for your support across our network for the Canadian Food Grains Bank. Onwards and upwards into 2021 altogether. I want you to know how much we appreciate you. Thanks.
The government of Canada promised back in 2020 that they would give the Food Grains Bank $2.3 million to help small-scale farmers impacted by the effects of the global pandemic if they could raise a contribution of $770,000. Thanks to the generosity of community like ours, they put out the appeal, we responded, and they did it. Our revised food jar campaign last year was able to raise some $4,640 to help them towards their goal. Joanna has posted more information on the outreach board in the Church Narthex about that. Folks, we must know that as we are open to receiving God's nudging, we do make a difference. Also, I appeal to the congregation to help accommodate a homeless couple in our community through this winter. And again, thanks to you, they are now able to sleep safe and warm until the spring. Here's the beautiful thank you card I received from them, along with some chocolates at Christmas time. They write, to all at Trinity Church, thank you for helping us and being there for us through this tough time for everyone. Yes to new beginnings and a happy new year to all. God bless. And God bless to all who have donated and helped us off the street, put a roof over our heads and help me get clean to new beginnings. And so let me end by asking for the last time today, just what are you hearing from God as you allow yourself to listen? How does what you may be hearing actually influence, affect, and affect your behavior? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you that you are always speaking, and especially that there are those times when you enable us actually to hear you speaking. Perhaps through nature, perhaps through other people, always through Scripture. Help us to hear you. We would listen more. We would be tuned in better. Hear us now, O God, as we bring our prayers of intercession. Praying against this COVID-19, we continue to pray against this pandemic, praying that those who are working so hard may be able to bring it under control. We pray for those caring for the vulnerable. We pray healing comfort for those who have been afflicted. We pray for your strength for those workers who have been most affected. Dear God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for the United States presidential inauguration that's happening this week. We continue to pray for healing of this deeply, deeply divided nation. In your mercy, dear God, hear our prayers. Invite you, whatever else is on your heart, hear us. Dear God, as we open our hearts and we pray together in the name of Jesus Christ. Now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught as we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now as you go out into this next week, may we do so knowing how we are being communicated with, how God is speaking. However dull our ears may be or dim our eyes may be, God is communicating. The same God of life and love and justice and hope and mercy and peace, communicating to us, communicating all of those things in Christ's name through us. May we go out having heard to be the blessing that God intends us to be, And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today and always. Amen.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain? Word of God, speak.